bear with me. Turn to Joshua chapter 3. We're going to begin reading in verse 1 of Joshua chapter 3. We're going to read down through verse 17 of Joshua chapter 3. Joshua chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. Joshua rose early in the morning, and they removed from Shittim and came to Jordan. He and all the children of Israel lodged there before they passed over. It came to pass after 3 days that the officers went throughout the host, and they commanded the people, saying, "When you see the ark of the covenant of the Lord your God, and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall remove from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Come not near unto it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go, for ye have not passed this way here before." And Joshua said unto the people, "Sanctify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." And Joshua spake unto the priests, saying, "Take up the ark of the covenant, and pass over before the people." And they took up the ark of the covenant, and went before the people. And the Lord said unto Joshua, "This day will I begin to magnify thee in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that as I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. Thou shalt command the priests that bear the ark of the covenant, saying, When they are come to the brink of the water of Jordan, ye shall stand still in Jordan." And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, "Come hither, and hear the words of the Lord your God." And Joshua said, "Hereby ye shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, and the Jebusites. Behold, the ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth passeth before you into Jordan. Now therefore take you 12 men out of the tribes of Israel, out of every tribe of man. It shall come to pass, as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the ark of the Lord, of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above, and they shall stand up upon a heap." It came to pass, the people removed from the tents to pass over Jordan, that the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the Lord, and as they that bear the ark were coming to Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for the Jordan was overflowing on both banks at the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up on a heap very far from the city of Adam, which is beside Zaratan. Those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right over Jordan, right over against Jericho. And the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan, and all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean before Jordan. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. I thank you for the opportunity we have to look at it today. I pray you'd speak to our hearts through it, Lord. Speak to us, Lord, through your word. Help us to see, Lord, through this Old Testament story, the principles that we need to understand, the truths that we need to learn. And I pray you bless what's done now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In the Exodus, God did many miraculous works. The people that were alive during the time of the Exodus saw many, many miracles. Plagues in Egypt. Water was turned to blood. Sky. The insects. All kinds of plagues. All kinds of things. They saw the death of the firstborn. They saw how if they put the blood over the door and on the side of the post, that they would be delivered from it. But everyone who didn't, by faith, trust God, they died. They saw the Red Sea crossing. They ate of the manna. They drank from the water out of the rock. They had experienced by faith. They had experienced what God had done. They'd seen the works of God. But see, because of man's failure to do what God said, every adult that was living at the time of the Exodus, with the exception of Joshua and Caleb, was dead. As they're coming now to the river, everyone who was above a certain age, I believe it was like 18 years old, everyone was dead. Go with me to Numbers chapter 14, verses 22 and following. I want us to look at this, just to kind take a look here. Numbers 14 is the passage where they had just came back from Kadesh Barnea. They were at the edge of Kadesh Barnea. They'd said the 12 spies over. They came back. They said, hey, it's a great place. It's a land that flows with milk and honey, but there's giants there. The 10 spies said, it's a great place. It's a good place. We understand what God wants us to do. It's a wonderful place, but we can't do it. And therefore, God doesn't expect us to do it, and we don't have to. And the other two, Joshua and Caleb, said, no. Yes, it's a land that flows with milk and honey. Yes, it's a wonderful place. Yes, it's a place where giants are. But if God told us to do it, God will give us the ability to do it. We need to do it. See, the difference in those guys was the difference in philosophy. One said, if God tells me to do it, I don't have an option. I have to obey. The other said, if God told me to do it, I'm only going to do it if it looks easy. Most oftentimes, it's not easy to do what God expects to do. God's will was good and God's will was clear, and both understood that. But the one group said, God's will isn't always possible to be done. Therefore, I don't have to do it. And they were the ones that died in the wilderness. In Numbers chapter 14, beginning in verse 22, I want us to begin reading there. It says, surely they shall not see the land which I swear unto their fathers, neither shall any of them that provoke me see it. But my servant Caleb, because he had another spirit with him, hath followed me fully, him will I bring into the land wherewith he went, and his seed shall possess it. Now the Amalekites, the Canaanites dwell in the valley, tomorrow turn you and get you into the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea. And the Lord spake unto Moses unto Aaron, saying, how long shall I bear with the Hebrew congregation which murmureth against me? I have heard the murmurings of the children of Israel which they murmured against me. Say unto them, as truly as I live, saith the Lord, as ye have spoken in my ears, so will I do to you. Your carcasses shall fall into this wilderness, and all that were numbered of you according to your old numbers, from there it is, from 20 years old and upward, ye shall yet which have murmured against me, doubtless. He shall come, shall not come into the land concerning which I spake. I swear to give, swear to make you dwell therein, save Caleb the son of Jephunneh and Joshua the son of Nun. But your little ones, which he said, should be a prey. They will I bring in. They shall know the land which ye have despised. But as for you, your carcasses, they shall fall in this wilderness. And your children shall wander in the wilderness 40 years, and bear your whoredoms, because until your carcasses be wasted in the wilderness, after the number of the days which ye search the land, even 40 each day for a year, shall ye bear again, including even 40 years, and ye shall know by breach of promise. Because they had decided to sin, decided to not follow what God had said they were to do, they all died. And they had said before, we don't want to go in there. Our kids will be prey for the enemies. God says, guess what? The prey are going to be the ones who are going to take that land. You're not going to go. They. In Joshua chapter 2, God had sent spies in to see the city of Jericho, spy out the land, not to decide if they should go or not. The 12 spies weren't to decide if they were to go or not either. They were to go in and view it and figure out how it was best to be done. They weren't to say yes or no. They were to say how. Well, these two came in with the same way. They didn't attempt to say yes or no. They viewed the land. They said, okay, this is where we're supposed to go. We're going to go to the city of Jericho. They meet up with Rahab. And as I mentioned last week, that's not by mistake. That was by design. They were supposed to meet Rahab because, number one, Rahab was ready to respond by faith. She already was searching. She was already looking. She had seen what had happened, and she was ready by faith to believe. They also were sent there, I believe, to be encouraged. So that when they would come back to Joshua, they would be able to encourage him. And as I mentioned last week, the verse at the end says, they said unto Joshua, truly the Lord hath delivered into our hands all the land. For even all the inhabitants of the country do faint because of us. They said, hey, it Jordan River is a flood stage. Now, there were times that the Jordan River was a muddy little stream and you could just walk across it. But there are times that the Jordan River is at flood stage where it overflows its banks, and it's actually a rather formidable thing. That's the time we're at right now, as we're told in the passage that it's overflowed. God says to the nation of Israel, I want you guys to prepare. I want you to get ready. I'm going to do some wonders. Look at verse 5. He says, Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourself for tomorrow. The Lord will do wonders among them. Now I want to challenge you. God wants to do wonders among us. He really truly does. He wants to do wonders among us. He wants to do wonders through us. He wants to do wonders with us. He wants to do amazing things that we don't even totally comprehend. It takes willing justice to learn to use. God wants to give us victory. He wants us to have victory. The book of Joshua, as I've mentioned, is a book of victory. It really truly is, compared to Numbers and all the books before that, in which they wandered around, the people complained, the people dropped dead, and all the kind of stuff. Those were just constant, terrible times. This is a book of God's working, a book of victory. I'm going to challenge you once again. God wants us to have victory. I think there's two things that I can see from this passage I want us to notice today. Two truths. First truth I want us to notice is that victory comes when you follow God's direction. Victory comes when we follow God's direction. Beginning in verse 1, I want you to notice, actually, we've got to skip down a few things. I'll start in verse 1. Now, we'll start in verse 1. Verse 3, and it commanded the people, saying, when you see the ark of the covenant of the Lord your God, the priests and the Levites bearing it, then shall you remove from your place and go after it. There's an emphasis in this passage on the Ark of the Covenant. Why? The Ark of the Covenant is God's presence then. It's where they saw God. It's where they saw God's presence. It was there where God met with people. It was there. His presence was there. He literally dwelled between the cherubims, we're told. In that box, there was contained jar of manna, so they'd remember what God had done. It contained the broken table of the law that Moses broke when they didn't do what they were supposed to do. And it contained the rod of Aaron that was budded. It was a staff. It budded to show that God was choosing Aaron as a leader to be the priest that God wanted to do. Those things were contained within that box. God's leading them. God had led them before. He had led them through the nation, through the land. He had led them through their entire wilderness wandering. He led them with a fiery pillar. He led them with a cloud. Now he's leading them once again, but they're seeing it one more time. First thing he tells them they have to do if they're going to actually be able to have that victory, they need to take care of the sin in their lives if they want to have victory. Look at verse 5. He says, and Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. The idea of the sanctify has consecrate. It's basically the idea of clean up your act, set yourself apart for God. Get prepared for God to use you. Remove the sin that's in your life. Get rid of it. Get yourself right with God. Get ready to serve God. Within it is the idea of being set apart for the use of God. He's saying, hey, with your sin. Every one of us sins. We all do. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs, verse 24, verse 17. Proverbs 24, 17. I'm going to read this because I quoted it two times today and I quoted it wrong both times. Proverbs 24, 17. It says this. I'm in Psalms. That's why I can't find it. Proverbs 24:17. Proverbs 24:17, it says this. That is an I wrote the wrong reference down.
You're on your own.
Well, if the verse says the righteous man falls seven times and rises again, I'll have to look it up for you. It's in there somewhere. I thought it was Proverbs 24:17, but apparently it's not. That's the verse. It says the righteous man falls seven times and gets up again. The idea is, it's not so much the fact that you don't sin that makes you righteous. 16? 16. 16? 24:16?
Yes.
How can I be that close and not see it?
Glasses.
That's probably it. Well, they have a crack in the lens. It makes it a little hard to use. Proverbs 24:16. Yeah, there you go. The just man falls seven times and rises up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief. Saying, I think what he's saying here is, it's not the just man is the guy who never sins. It's a guy that when he does what is right, when he sins, he gets back up, dusts himself off, takes care of his relationship with God, and goes on once more. In all, in our Christian life, if we expect to never do anything wrong, we're in a lot of trouble. I mean, maybe you're better than me, but I know I'm not at that point, and I don't think I ever will be. I'll never be to the point where I don't sin. I'm always doing stuff I shouldn't do, whether it's in my thought, or whether it's something I say, or something I think. There's always things I have to deal with. And you know what, you can get to the point where you can say, well, you know what, I might as well just quit because I can't do it right. God says, no, 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 no. A just man falls seven times in one day and gets back up and keeps on going. How does he get back up and keep on going? He gets back up and keeps on going by confessing his sin. The Bible says that we confess our sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The key to success, what? What?
Verse 6 in the same chapter. The 1 John 1, 9 equivalent.
I don't even have that passage there anymore, but I can look at it. 24:6?
No, 16:6. The 1 John 1, 9 equivalent.
I was in the other version. Okay, Proverbs 16:6. We'll look at that one. By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged, and the fear of the Lord men depart from evil. Yeah. So yeah, basically the idea is the same idea as confessing your sins and not forgiving us. God, you know what? In all reality, the key to success in our Christian life isn't not ever doing things wrong. It's when we do things that are wrong, confessing it to God, and getting ourselves right with Him. There are many, many people I've dealt with over the years, and some people that I've known very well, who got saved, and then things happened in their life, and they just kind of fell away. Was it a question of them not really ever getting saved? I don't really think it was. I think it was in fact they never learned to deal with the sin when it had committed. So they fell again, and they gave up, and they quit, and they said, I'm done. I'm going back. I'm never going to do this again. I want to challenge you. Victory comes when we take care of sin in our life. We want victory, we need to deal with that sin in our life. Not only do we want need to take care of sin in our life if we want victory, we need to follow God's word if we want victory. Look at verse 9 in this passage. And Joshua said to the children of Israel, come hither and hear the words of the Lord your God. He says, come here. Come on, guys. And, you know, this is quite an interesting thing because he's got a lot of people there. This is a large crowd of people. How exactly many the Exodus involved, we're not really 100% sure. But the guess is that there's probably well over, they say they came out of Egypt somewhere around 2 million people. So by the time they got to the edge of the promised land, we're looking at a lot of people. Of just the tribes, Ephraim, Manasseh, and Reuben, Gad, the half tribe of Manasseh, there were 100,000 fighting men.
So 100,000 fighting men from just that group. This is a large group of people. He gathers them together. He says, come on, guys. Come over here. We're going to listen to God's word. We're going to do it right this time. We're going to follow God's word. We're going to know what God says. And he's very specific as what he says. He says, well, here's what you're going to do. You're going to watch the Ark of the Covenant. When the Ark of the Covenant begins to move, when God starts moving, you're going to follow. And they were told, but you're not going to get real close. You're going to stay back. You're going to give it the respect it's due. He says, I want you to stay back 2,000 cubits, 1,000 yards, he said. Stay way back. Why is he keeping them back so far? I think he wants them to see what's going to happen. Because this is going to be a cool thing. They're staying back to watch what's going to happen. Because, see, they're going to walk into this river. The river's flowing. And God says, I want you to get the priests, and I want you to just keep right on going. Walking right into the river. See, if we're going to have God's word, if we're going to follow God's word, if we want victory, we need to know God's word. Talked about that a little bit this morning, talked about that quite often, and it's the truth of it. We need to take the time to study God's word. We really, truly do. The Bible says in the book of 2 Peter that we're to be ready to give an answer to every man that asks about the hope of the reason that's within us with meekness and fear. We need to know the word of God. Well, why? Why should I know the word of God? Why does it really matter? Well, I need to know the word of God because, number one, I have to be able to give an answer to someone else. Number two, I need to know the word of God because it really is what gives me the ability to be successful in my life. You know, we want to be successes. Everybody wants to be a success. We want our kids to be successes. We want them to, you know, be successful in whatever they do. But the Word of God is what makes it not successful necessarily in business, but what can make you successful in life. God says, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. And thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy ways prosperous. And then thou shalt have good success. God says, you want to be successful. You want to be prosperous in your life. You want to be successful in your life. You want to be a success in my eyes, God says. Begin the word of God. Let the word of God be in you. Allow it to control you. They were told to know it. They said, come near, near your God. They were told to do it. They were very specific as to what they were to do. There was a certain amount of space in between them. They were to do certain things. They were to follow them. They were to watch. Because God wanted them to see what was going to happen. See, victory comes when we follow God's direction. We get God's direction through His Word. They got it, you know, through God speaking to Joshua as He spoke to Moses and all that stuff. But you know what? We can look and go, well, I wish it was like that today. I wish that we could get God's word directly from us. Directly from heaven for me. We do. We have the word of God directly from heaven for us. Kept for me and kept for you in a way that's much better than what they ever had. They got to hear it once. We get to read it all the time. We get to know it. We get to learn it. You know, I've used the illustration before. Love letters, you know? Sandy and I were right. We spent a lot of our time, our dating relationship, a lot of it was long distance. I met her, and then she went away to college, and I was in seminary. She was in Indiana, I was in Lansdale. And when she came back from Indiana, she went up to New York State for a while. And then I was in Lansdale. And she went to Central Pennsylvania, and I was in Lansdale. And then she, you know, never were we really, then she eventually she was back in Strasburg, and I still was in Lansdale most of the time, except when we get to. Most of our time was spent writing letters back and forth. Writing cards, writing letters. And many, many times, spent a lot of time reading those letters. Trying to figure out the intimate details, you know, trying to exegete the letters, you know, trying to figure out exactly what it means. You know, she says this, what does that mean? Can't wait to see you this weekend.
What? Now, what does everyone mean?
You know, with this, what is that actually? What's the, you know, because we want to try to figure out all the things of what those things actually mean. We have the Word of God. We need to spend the time learning it. It's God's love letter to us. He talks about His love for us, His love that sent His Son, the Logos, and His love that also gave us His word. We need to take the time to spend time and read it and learn. See, this victory comes when we follow God's direction. When we do things God's way, we do what God wants us to do. Not only does victory come when we follow God's direction, another truth I'd like us to notice is victory comes when we step out in faith. Joshua chapter 3, beginning in verse 12. Now therefore take you 12 men out of the tribes of Israel, out of every tribe of man. It shall come to pass as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the ark of the Lord of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the water of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above, and they shall stand upon it. It shall come to pass that people will remove from their tents to pass over Jordan, the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the Lord. And they bear the ark, and they that bear the ark were coming to Jordan, and that feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water of Jordan, for Jordan overflowed all its banks in time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city of Adam, that is at the side of Zaratan, and those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salts that failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. Priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until the people could pass clean over Jordan. Now we said here, this is the Jordan River is an overflowing flood stage. So this is quite wide. There's quite a bit of water. It's probably rushing pretty fast. It's quite probably a rather impressive thing. You know, God could have used anything He wanted to make it easy for them to get across. He could have built a bridge. You know, He could have caused an earthquake to drop the rocks across there so they never walked across. In fact, He could have had an earthquake block up the Jordan River like happened in 1927 when an earthquake took place right near the city of Jericho and blocked up the Jordan River for 21 hours. He could have did that. If He wanted to, He could have. But what He did instead is He said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to wait till the priest's feet are in the water before I'm going to stop the water. And then I'm going to make it pile up on one side. And all the rest is going to go away. And you're going to cross on dry ground. This is just as a miraculous thing as happened at the Exodus. The Lord intentionally tested the Israelites' faith at the Jordan River, just as He had done when they left Egypt 40 years before. You know, the Exodus, God led Moses to set his camp right by the Red Sea. This was a major military blunder in the eyes of the Pharaoh. I'm sure Pharaoh is looking at it going, ha ha, got it now! There's no way out! See, for God, it was an opportunity to demonstrate His power for Moses and the people, and for that matter, for Pharaoh to see. Because He was able to open that river up, open that sea up, dry the ground up. The Jordan, the crossing of the Red Sea is just an amazing thing. You read everything about it, and people were always trying to figure out ways to explain it. Well, when they crossed where there were sandbars. Oh, well, this is what happened, and this is what happened. And every explanation fails to make the answer, because here's a couple things. Number one, God opened it up. They crossed on dry ground. And they said, well, hey, you know, the ocean, you know, was the Red Sea was low at that time. They walked across on sandbars. It was easy.
apparently.
Pharaoh didn't know that because he got his chariot stuck there and they all drowned in the sea. Either way you cut it, it's a miraculous event. An amazing event, and God did something very similar once again to the Israelite people. He said that I want you to come. I want you to all get ready. I want you, as soon as you see the priest moving, I want you to all get up and get ready. I want you all to see this. But I want you to stand back because I want you to see how magnificent this is. Because, hey, you know what? When the river stops, it's piling up on the one side. Now, why is it not piling up on the other side? It's a river. The other side's going away. And so it's all going to be piled up, and the way the current's coming, and they're crossing on God. See, victory comes when we step out in faith. And sometimes that requires getting your feet wet. You see, sometimes things don't make sense. God tells us what to do in His Word, and it doesn't always make sense to us. But Lord, if I do that, that's not going to work. That doesn't make sense to me. Lord, if I treat people kindly who treat me mean, that doesn't make sense. You know, be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. That doesn't make sense. I'll be quite frank with you. In the world's perspective, that doesn't make sense. The world says it this way. I don't get mad. I get even. People say, you know, hey, you do something to me, I'll get you. It doesn't matter how long it takes. It doesn't matter how much I have to do. I'll get you back. That's the world's perspective. But God's perspective is to be kind to them and forgive them. It doesn't make sense. But God says, sometimes you have to step out in faith and do what I tell you. Sometimes you have to get your feet wet and then watch people. You know, whole Christian life revolves around faith. It really truly does. As Bob had said earlier, even understanding God involves faith because we can't understand God. Because He exists beyond the realm of time. He exists totally, we don't understand it. And it doesn't matter how many months or years or days or weeks I've spent studying theology. I don't understand God any better, really, in that regard than anyone else. Because it doesn't make sense. It also doesn't make sense that a God that exists beyond the realm of time loved me. Why? Why? That makes no sense to me. It makes no sense for any reason. See, God loved us. Nothing sent His Son. We are saved by faith. And each day of our life, we have to live by faith. The Bible says in the book of Habakkuk, the just shall live by faith. Faith is required to live the Christian life in everything we do. And sometimes, as I say, you've got to get your feet wet. It doesn't make sense. You're going to step out. You're going to do something. You're going to say, okay, God, You said to do it. I'm going to follow what You said in Your Word. I'm going to do it. Not going to work out, but I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to watch God. I want to challenge you. God wants to do wonders among us. He wants to give us the victory. But it involves us following Him, following His Word, and stepping out in faith and doing what He tells us. So that He can be wonders. So let's look in one prayer. Father, I thank You for this day You've given. I thank You for Your Word today. I pray You'd help us, each one of us, Lord, today, to follow You. That we would allow You, Lord, to work in our lives. That we would listen to Your Word, Lord, and do what You say because You say. Not because it makes sense to us, but because You tell us to do it. pray he lives and bless and all's done now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.